This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Science of Religion by Yogananda Paramahansa. Preface. This book is intended to give, in bare outline, what we should understand by religion in order to make it universally and pragmatically necessary. It also seeks to present that aspect of the idea of the Godhead which has a direct bearing on the motives and actions of every minute of our lives. It is true that God is infinite in His nature and aspect, and it is also true that to prepare a chart detailing, so far as is consistent with reason, what God is like is only an evidence of the limitations of the human mind in its attempt to fathom God. Still, it is equally true that the human mind, in spite of all its drawbacks, cannot rest perfectly satisfied with what is finite. It has a natural urge to interpret what is human and finite in the light of what is superhuman and infinite, what it feels but cannot express, what within it lies implicit, but under circumstances refuses to be explicit. Our ordinary conception of God is that He is superhuman, infinite, omnipresent, omniscient, and the like. In this general conception, there are many variations. Some call God personal, some impersonal, and so forth. The point emphasized in this book is that whatever conception we have of God, if it does not influence our daily conduct, if everyday life does not find an inspiration from it, and if it is not found universally necessary, then that conception is worse than useless. If God is not conceived in such a way that we cannot do without Him in the satisfaction of a want, in our dealings with people, in earning money, in reading a book, in passing an examination, in the doing of the most trifling or the highest duties, then it is better we should act discreetly, taking His useless name less into churches and temples. God may be infinite, omnipresent, omniscient, personal, merciful, or anything, but these conceptions are not sufficiently compelling to make us try to know God. We may as well do without Him. He may be infinite, omnipresent, and so forth, but we have no immediate and practical use for those conceptions in our busy, rushing lives. We fall back on those conceptions only when we seek to justify, in philosophical and poetical writings, in art or in warmed-up idealistic talks, the finite craving for something beyond, when we, with all our wanted knowledge, are at a loss to explain some of the most common phenomena of the universe, or when we get stranded in the vicissitudes of the world. We pray to the ever-merciful when we get stuck, as the Eastern maxim has it. Except for all this, we seem to get along all right in our workaday world without Him. These conceptions appear to be the safety valves of our pent-up human thought. They explain Him, but do not make us seek Him. They lack motive power. We are not necessarily seeking God when we call Him infinite, omnipresent, all-merciful, and so forth. These conceptions satisfy our intellect, but do not soothe our soul. If respected and cherished at heart, they may broaden us to a certain extent, may make us moral and resigned towards Him. But they do not make God our own, they are not intimate enough. They place Him aloof from everyday concern of the world. These conceptions savor of outlandishness when we are on the street, in a factory, behind a counter, or in an office. Not because we are really dead to God and religion, but because we lack a proper conception of them, a conception that can be interwoven with the fabric of daily life. What we conceive of God should be of daily, nay hourly guidance to us. The very conception of God should stir us to seek Him in the midst of our daily lives. This is what we mean by a pragmatic and compelling conception of God. We should take religion and God out of the sphere of belief into that of daily life. If we do not emphasize the necessity of God in every aspect of our lives and the need of religion in every minute of our existence, then God and religion drop out of our intimate daily consideration and become only a one-day-in-a-week affair. In the first chapter of this work, the attempt has been made to show that in order to understand the real necessity of God and religion, we must throw emphasis on that conception of both which is most relevant to the chief aim of our daily and hourly actions. This book has also attempted to show the universality and unity of religion. There have been different religions at different ages. There have been heated controversy, long warfare, and much bloodshed over them. One religion stood against another, one sect fought with another. Not only is there a variety in religions, but there is also a wide diversity of sects and opinions within the same religion. But the question arises, when there is one God, why there should be so many religions? It may be argued that particular stages of intellectual growth and special types of mentality belonging to certain nations, due to different geographical locations and other extraneous circumstances, determine the origin of different religions, such as Hinduism and Buddhism for the Indians and the Asiatics, Mohammedanism for the Arabs, at least at its beginning, Christianity for the Westerners, and so forth. If by religion we understand only practices, particular tenets, dogmas, customs and conventions, then Ihan may be ground for the existence of so many religions. But if religion means primarily God consciousness, or the realization of God both within and without, which it really does, secondarily a body of beliefs, tenets and dogmas, then strictly speaking, there is but one religion in the world, for there is but one God, and different customs, forms of worship, tenets and conventions may be held to form the grounds for the origin of different denominations and sects included under that one religion. If religion is understood in this way, then and then only can its universality be maintained, for we cannot possibly universalize particular customs or conventions. Only the element common to all the so-called religions can be universalized. We can ask everyone to follow that. Then can it be truly said that religion is not only necessary, but it is universal as well. Everyone must follow the same religion, for there is but one, its universal element being one and the same. Only its customs and conventions differ. I have tried to show in this book that as God is one, necessary for all of us, so religion is one, necessary and universal. Only the roads to it may differ in some respects at the beginning. As a matter of fact, it is ludicrous to say that there are two religions when there is but one God. There may be two denominations or sects, but there is only one religion. What we now call different religions should be known as different denominations or sects under that one universal religion. And what we now know as different denominations or sects should be specified as different branch cults or creeds. If we once know the meaning of the word religion, which we are going to discuss by and by, we shall naturally be very circumspect in the use of it. It is only the limited human point of view that overlooks the underlying universal element in the so-called different religions of the world, and this overlooking has been the cause of many evils. This book gives a psychological definition of religion, not an objective definition based on dogmas or tenets. In other words, it seeks to make religion a question of our whole inward being and attitude, and not a mere observance of certain rules and precepts, nor an intellectual acquiescence either, in certain beliefs about God, the universe, and so forth. On this psychological ground, its universality has been established. I have also discussed the merits and demerits of the different methods required to be followed for the attainment of that religious consciousness which is here set forth. In conclusion, it should be remembered that when the theory and practice of religion are poles apart, we must not stop at the theory and lose energy over comment or criticism thereon, leaving out of sight the practical aspect of it that alone can lead to its true understanding. The verification of a theory lies in practice. If a practice truly followed is found at last to militate against the theory, then, and not till then, may the theory be safely rejected. Chapter 1. The Universality, Necessity and Oneness of Religion, the Distinction between Pleasure, Pain and Bliss, God. First we must know what religion is, then only can we judge whether it is necessary for all of us to be religious. Without necessity, there is no action. Every action of ours has an end of its own for which we perform it. People of the world act variously to accomplish various ends. There is a multiplicity of ends determining the actions of men in the world. But is there any common and universal end of all the actions of all the people of the world? Is there any common, highest necessity for all of us which prompts us to all actions? A little analysis of the motives and ends of men's actions in the world shows that, though there are 1,001 proximate or immediate ends of men in regard to the particular calling or profession which they take up, the ultimate end which all other ends merely subserve comes to be the avoidance of pain and want and the attainment of permanent bliss. Whether we can at all permanently avoid pain and want and get bliss is a separate question. But as a matter of fact, in all our actions, we obviously try to avoid the former and get the latter. Why does a man act as a probationer? Because he wishes to become an expert in a certain business. Why does he engage in that particular business? Because money can be earned therein. Why should money be earned at all? Because it will put an end to personal and family wants. Why must wants be fulfilled? Because pain will thereby be removed and bliss or happiness be gained. As a matter of fact, happiness and bliss.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.